Hello and welcome. I'm Vishal Dahiya and you're watching our special election series Battleground 2021, where we bring you a detailed analysis of election news and views from the poll-bound states. Now, the next half an hour, we'll bring to you the analysis of second phase of polling in West Bengal and Assam, which took place today. After days of high decibel campaigning by political parties, voting for the second phase of assembly elections in West Bengal and Assam happened today. Till 6 p.m., West Bengal had recorded 80.43% voter turnout and Assam registered 73.03% turnout. These figures, however, could change once the Election Commission updates the latest data. A total of 69 seats spread across both the states, 30 out of 294 assembly constituencies in West Bengal and 39 out of 126 seats in Assam are at stake in this phase, where all eyes obviously will be on Nandigram, where Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee is locked in a fierce prestige battle with Suvendu Adhikari of the BJP, who was at one time Mamata Banerjee's close aide. Now, Assam will vote in just one more phase on 6th of April. The polling in West Bengal will take place in six more phases, with the last one, that is the eighth phase, taking place on 29th of April. Coming back to this particular phase, the TMC and BJP had fielded their candidates in all the 30 assembly seats in West Bengal, while the CPIM did so in just 15. The alliance partners of left Sanjukta Morcha, the Congress and ISF had tried their luck in 13 and 2 seats respectively. In Assam, the second phase of polling included 12 districts from Central Assam and Lower Assam. BJP Minister Parimal Shukla-Baidya, Congress leader Kamakhya Prasad Mala, Deputy Speaker Animul Haq Laskar and AIUDF's Karimuddin Barbhuiya were some of the prominent faces in the fray in this phase in Assam. Significantly, in 2016 assembly elections, the Trinmul had won 21 of the 30 seats which were on offer today. And in Assam, the BJP had won 22 of the 39 seats which went to the polls in the second phase today. So let's start analyzing the situation which took place on the ground in these two states today. And for, to better understand that particular scenario, we have with us two distinguished guests. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with Mr. Sandeep Phukan, Deputy Editor of The Hindu, keeps a close watch on the developments in Assam. Also, we have Mr. Jayanta Bhattacharya, Senior Journalist, joining us to give his take on West Bengal. Let's start with West Bengal first, Jayanta. And obviously, this was a very, very key phase as far as West Bengal is concerned, because of the simple fact that one of the constituencies out of the 30 was Nandigram. Quite a lot of action happened there today as well.
Yes, indeed. You rightly pointed out about Nandigram. In fact, there are talks going on whether this is the constituency which will return the future chief minister of West Bengal. Now, that's too far-fetched, so we will have to wait and see. But if we go back, say, about 14 years back, in the past, I remember those days that we used to cover Nandigram and the adjoining areas. That is when Nandigram first came into focus. It was Shubhendu Adhikari who was not really inside Nandigram, but he was all around. It appeared that he was all over the place, but once in a while entering, but then exiting as if he could not be seen. He would come, he would go, and he would not really at that time, what, about 35, 36 years old maybe. And that time he would travel like in an ambulance, sometimes in a gypsy, which would look like a police car. And that is how he would move around. And that Shubhendu Adhikari, after that, obviously, he rose in the ranks, became very close to Mamata Banerjee, one of her trusted lieutenants, who was given the task of organizing the Trinamool Congress in 5 or 6 different districts. That Shubhendu Adhikari today is taking on Mamata Banerjee, and Mamata Banerjee moving away from her own constituency into Nandigram. So obviously, all eyes are on Nandigram. Mm-hmm. As you rightly said, the voting is still going on, but we'll have to wait and see what is the turnout. Right now, the turnout is much less than what it was in 2016, when Shubhendu Adhikari had won in 2016. So if there is less voting, what the news that is coming from the ground is that Shubhendu Adhikari may hold an edge, but we'll have to wait and see.
Okay, definitely. One time Brodji against his mentor out there. Quite an interesting battle, and definitely all eyes are on Nandigram. But Jayanto, apart from Nandigram, you know, out of these 30 seats which went to polls today, what are the other key constituencies or key faces one should watch out for when the results start rolling out on 2nd of May?
I would say interesting would be, again, in the same district is Shobong. Shobong has always been a very strong Congress. Congress hold always was very strong over there, where Manas Bhuiya, who was earlier with the Congress, a senior Congress leader, he used to represent that constituency. But later, he switched over to the Trinamool Congress, and his wife had contested from Shobong after he vacated the constituency. But this time, again, he is contesting from there. He has been a minister in Mamata Banerjee earlier also, when he was in the Congress, and the Trinamool Congress and the Congress together had formed a government. He was a minister. Later, he joined the Trinamool Congress and then went to the Rajya Sabha. So that would be another, perhaps, constituency that we have to keep an eye on. But I would say overall, all the 30 seats would be important because of the change that happened in voting pattern between 2016 and 2019. That is the Vidhan Sabha election and the Lok Sabha election later. The way the tides turned, there was a time when in 2016, out of these 30, only one seat went to the BJP, that was Dilip Ghosh from Kharagpur. But when he vacated the seat to contest from Midnapur for the Lok Sabha, that seat again during the bipole went to the Trinamool Congress. So we have to wait and see that whether it's the 29, of course, Vidhan Sabha, Lok Sabha, the issues, the voting pattern, they are different. But we really have to wait and see what happens in all those 30 seats, in fact, on 2nd May.
Okay, definitely. And we will keep a close watch there. And we'll come back to you, Jayanto, and we'll talk about, these dynamics as well, the numbers which were there in 2016 and in 2019. And this time around, the kind of lineup which both the parties have there, we'll do a bit more detailed analysis there. But let's also shift focus to Assam here. 39 seats, quite significant there. Sandeep, 73.03% till 6 p.m., are you satisfied with the kind of voter turnout which is there in terms of, the expectations? Obviously, this number will improve as time goes by. Maybe it may further rise to around 75 odd percentage points. But voter turnout, one fact here. And obviously, the big faces, some of the names I mentioned, any other which you would like to point out?
No, I think you've summarized pretty much, these the big names. Porimal Shukrabadhyay is a sitting minister. Another minister whose fate will be, decided in this phase is in Jagir Road, Piju Hazarika. He is a minister of state for health, someone who is known to be very close to Himanta Biswa Sarma. And that is perhaps the reason why he's a minister of state. He's the junior health minister in the state. He's also contesting from Jagir Road. So then there is Barhampur, which used to be the seat of former Chief Minister Prafulla Kumar Mahanta, but because of ill health, he is not contesting these elections. So that is another interesting seat that we'll have to watch out for. But I think what is the larger picture here, Vishal, couple of points. One is that the Barak Valley, this is really the Bengali heartland. Barak Valley will be voting. Two things that one needs to look out for. When you must have seen that in the entire Assam campaign, the focus has been against, and from the opposition at least, opposition parties have been saying that if we come to power, we will say no to Citizenship Amendment Act. And that is an emotional issue. And they tried to make that the political and the main electoral plank, especially the Congress-led Mahajot of 10 parties. But if there is one place where there is tremendous acceptance for the Citizenship Amendment Act, it is in areas of Barak Valley, where the Bengali Hindu voters are in substantial numbers. Why so? Because these are people, who have been there without a proper, their status is always gray. Mm-hmm. They are not foreigners. But they are not citizens either. So, and there is a large chunk of population like that in these areas, in the areas like Silchar that I mentioned. It is part of Barak Valley. So this is, you know, in areas where the Bengali Hindus are in majority, it is very interesting how this will play out.
Okay.
I'm told that there is a bit of division within the BJP camp over seat distribution, but will they be strong enough to sort of upset the BJP, or will CAA actually determine the results there in these seats where the Bengali Hindu population is in a decisive number?
Okay.
The other factor that one should look out for is the alliance between the Congress and the AIUDF, Mr. Ajmal's All India United Democratic Front.
Mm-hmm.
How it plays out, because there are also several seats in the Barak Valley region that are minority dominated. So how are these seats going to play out? I think these are two very important points that we'll have to watch out in this phase, apart from, of course, other lower Assam areas.
Okay, definitely. And you know, since you mentioned the alliance part there and issues, obviously, when we're looking at the Assam elections, every phase have their own unique set of issues there. But when we're to, you know, look at the absolute numbers out there, obviously, they'll be out for everyone to see on the 2nd of May. But if we're doing a bit of a comparison, then in 2016, out of these 39 seats, BJP had a very comfortable sailing in 22 of them. So, you know, do you think that this particular phase is really significant both for BJP, the incumbent, which wants to retain power because they should, you know, at least win those 22 seats, and for the challengers as well, because they need to go ahead and retain the lost ground here?
Yes. Well, I would imagine that the most crucial phase for the BJP would have been phase one. And, you know, 47 seats went to polls. Most of these seats were in Upper Assam. Some of them is what we call as the North Bank areas. This is the North Bank of Brahmaputra. So, you know, areas like Dhemaji, Lokhimpur, these are the areas that we call as North Bank areas. So 47 seats, most crucial. So if BJP manages, just to give you an analysis or comparison, last time around in 2016, the BJP-AGP alliance got 35 out of 47. So they will at least have to repeat the same number, if not more. In fact, they should, in my opinion, they should be able to do better than the last time to compensate for any slippages that they may have in the next two phases. That is the phase that voted today and the coming up, and the phase that goes to polls on 6th of April.
Mm-hmm.
Why do I say so? You talked about 22 seats in the previous election in 2016. Don't forget, Vishal, that the difference between 2016 and 2021 is that at that point of time, Congress and All India United Democratic Front, Mr. Ajmal's party, they were fighting separately.
Okay.
And there was a lot of division of minority votes. You know, and the BJP managed to scrape through on many seats. The margin of victory was less than 5,000. And if there was a consolidation of minority votes and anti-BJP votes, the results may have been very different.
Okay.
And the BJP is aware of it. So, of course, they would like to retain 22 seats. If they retain, great. But as I said, the things have changed. Permutation, and even in the last show, I had talked about various permutation and combination. For example, in the third phase, in the third phase, in the Boroland, Boro territorial region, there are 12 seats. All 12 of them were swept by the Boro People's Front. But this time, Boro People's Front is in opposition to the BJP. They are part of the Mahajot and they are contesting all 12 seats. In fact, I think one of their contenders have today joined the BJP in the presence of Narendra Singh Tomar. So at least one seat they are less. So one person has switched sides. He has switched sides. He has walked out of BPF, Boro People's Front, and he has joined the BJP. But as I said, that will be a factor in the next phase. So there are many factors, and you are absolutely right, Vishal. Every phase has a unique characteristic in this Assam poll. So as I said, this poll will test the popularity of BJP's promise of giving citizenship, especially among Bengali Hindus in the Bengali heartland of Barak Valley. It will also test the coming together of the alliance. How well does the alliance work on the ground? Because many of these AIUDF MLAs, when we talk about minority votes, we assume that, you know, Muslims will only vote for the AIUDF or the Congress.
Okay.
That's not the case. On the ground, you hear many reports of very strong anti-incumbency against sitting lawmakers of AIUDF.
Okay.
So, you know, would the Muslim voter be looking for a third option? There are some regional parties, Raisor Dol, Ahom Jatiya Porishad. These are new parties that have come out of CAA. So it's going to be an interesting battle.
Definitely. And these permutation combinations which you're pointing out to, Sandeep, makes it more interesting on the ground there. We'll have to wait and watch as to what exactly has happened to the fate of those 300-odd candidates who were in the fray today in Assam for those 39 seats. And that would obviously be known on 2nd of May. Let's now come back to West Bengal. And Mr. Bhattacharya, as you know, you were earlier referring to, if you're looking at the same comparison which you're doing about for Assam from the 2016 figures, then the TMC had, 21 seats, if I'm not wrong, out of those 30 in 2016. And the scenario changed a lot in 2019 Lok Sabha elections. If we have to look at the Leeds assembly constituency-wise in those, Lok Sabha constituencies. This time around, when you see the lineup on both sides of the candidates, do you think that both parties, the TMC and the BJP, had kept that in mind? And obviously the change scenario in 2019 as well.
Yes, the face, of course, matters. But what we see right now in West Bengal, and this has been happening earlier also, it's a very leader-based campaign that is going on. It's the charisma or the personality of the leader that is being taken into consideration. Mm-hmm. Say, for example, if you go back in the, when the left front was in power, it was the personality of Jyoti Basu that was carrying the left front along. Later on, Buddhadev Bhattacharya also, he became a kind of a poster boy of reforms, of development, of industry, which the left was not doing, but he could not evolve into that kind of a personality. Later came Mamata Banerjee. In fact, if you remember, in 2016 and even 2019, when there was a kind of a flood of BJP supporters, of BJP leaders coming onto the political arena in West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee used to say that whether you are voting in the 42 Lok Sabha seats or you are voting for the 294 assembly constituencies, remember you are voting for me. That is, Mamata Banerjee was the face in all these constituencies that were going to the polls. Similarly, if you see, it is the charisma of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi that is carrying the Bharatiya Janata Party forward. Even in West Bengal, they have not named a chief minister. Of course, it's not mandatory to name a chief minister because the proper process is that the first the elections will be held, then the MLAs will sit together and they will decide who will be the leader of the house for them. And then he or she will be the chief minister.
Mm-hmm.
But everywhere that you see that it is the charisma, it is the work of Narendra Modi that is being discussed, that is being put forward. So here, more than the personal faces, of course, both the parties, they're trying to cash in on, say, for example, sportsmen of, cine stars and all that. But at the end of the day, it's a clash of the personalities who are going to pull the party ahead for either, I mean, for whether BJP or the Trinamool Congress. And that is what is playing on the field.
Okay. That's also a very, very important aspect of the, polls in assembly polls in West Bengal this time around, as Mr. Bhattacharya is pointing out. One more fact here, Mr. Bhattacharya, is that so far two phases are over. But if you look at the overall strength of the West Bengal assembly, then just around one-fifth of the, assembly seats have been, polled for. So a large chunk of this electoral battle still remains. Six more phases to go. So in terms of that part of the battle, how do you see it moving from here onwards? We've seen the first phase of polling. We've seen the second phase as well. The way the electorate is coming out to cast their vote, the kind of, high-pitched campaign which is there from both sides, and obviously the third player as well, the left and the Congress, they're doing their bit to try and, keep their foot in the door out there.
Yes, let me start from the last part that you mentioned. That is about the United Front, as they are calling themselves, the third the third alternative, which is the Congress, the Left Front, and the ISF, the Indian Secular Front, which was launched by the Pirzada Furfura Sharif in West Bengal. Now, what they are cashing in on, as they are claiming, is that they are targeting the anti-incumbency, those who are angry, who are fed up with the present government. They are saying that those are the people who will not vote for the BJP, will vote for them. Now, mm-hmm. Here is the question. How many of these people who are fed up with the Trinamool Congress is against the BJP? Because they have seen the BJP at the national level and they know that what they have delivered. But in West Bengal, this new generation, they will have to decide between the two. That is what the people on the ground are talking about. Now, next, let's come to the second part of it. That is about the other parts of the state. Now, this particular region that went to the polls in the first phase and the second, a large part of it was from that area which is the border with the states like Odisha and Jharkhand, that particular area, where, in fact, another thing you mentioned is about the turnout. Now, mm-hmm. In these areas, it's very warm. It's very the temperature is very high. Even today, I heard it was hovering around 38 degrees to 40 degrees. And in fact, it was more so on the ground. Now, here, the people, they come early in the morning. And that is why election started earlier in the day, also because of the law and order situation. It started earlier in the day. And if you see that even by around early afternoon, we can say that there were about 60% of polling, but then it was started to drop. So I have a little doubt that maybe this time around, the voting may not be, although what I hear just now, that there in certain polling booths, polling is still going on, but it may not touch the figures that it had in the last election, 2016, but we'll have to wait and see.
Mm-hmm.
Now, coming to the first question that you pointed out is the rest of the state. Now, this particular part, as I was mentioning earlier, is where in 2019, the BJP did pretty well. That is the two Midnapur districts, Purulia, Bankura. But now it is slowly entering the area where the Trinamool Congress claims to have a better hold. That is the area where, say, the minority voters are much more in number. Say, for example, places like the south, north, south, can I say? Say, mm-hmm. Say, or let's say Malda, let us say Murshidabad. These are the area where the minority voters come something more than half, so close to 60% or so. So all these areas, the Trinamool Congress is claiming that it will be going in their favor. So in a way, we can say that Trinamool was ready, except for Nandigram, underlined. They were almost, they had almost accepted that this particular region may not go very favorably for them. That mm-hmm. is something around about 90 odd seats.
Okay. Let's take a quick concluding comment from Sandeep here as well regarding the third and the last phase in Assam. Sandeep, you mentioned the BPF angle there for the third phase specifically, and that obviously is going to be really important. But apart from that, what is it that we can expect in Assam in the third and final phase?
Well, Vishal, before I forget, I was listening intently to Jayanta Da. So I just remembered a phrase that I read, Nandigrame Shangram. You know, there's a battle going on in Nandigram of all the 30 seats. That is where all the center of attraction is.
Indeed.
As far as the third phase is concerned, Vishal, I think this is where the 40 seats, of course, and this is where a lot will depend on how well this alliance does, because many of these seats, I mean, you know, broadly, I can tell you that of the 79 seats that goes to poll between today and April 6th, today 39 and 40 in the next phase. So mm-hmm. of these 79, there are nearly 30 seats where the minority factor, the Ajmal factor, call it whatever you like, will play out. Because they are the determining factor in who wins or who loses.
Okay.
So as I told you that in the last time, because there was a split in the minority votes, there were many seats where, by very small margins, BJP went through. But this time around, will that change? Will the BJP get really tough competition from the alliance? Or, as I also mentioned, that there is anti-incumbency against sitting MLAs, minority MLAs, And will the minority voter choose someone else? And in that case, it will be advantage BJP. So, I mean, we'll have to wait how this pans out. But this is very crucial. The last phase is very crucial in terms of alliances. Because in terms of alliances, at least on paper, the Congress, AIUDF and BPF, Boro People's Front Alliance, on paper, they look strong. But we all know that many a times things really play out differently on the ground.
Definitely. And whether what is strong on paper also turns out to be strong on the ground is something which we will only know on 2nd of May. Thank you so much, Sandeep Phukan out there, and Jayanta Bhattacharya as well, for bringing us these inputs and analysis on the second phase of West Bengal and Assam assembly elections. While Assam will have its third and final phase on 6th of April, the state of West Bengal will have six more phases, the final on 29th of April. And as our panelists were pointing out, it's not only the weather temperature which is rising in the state, the political temperature is also steadily on the rise. We'll keep a watch on that. We'll keep on bringing you all the details, inputs, reports and analysis on these two states, as well as the state of Kerala and Tamil Nadu and the Union Territory of Puducherry as well, where the assembly elections are to be held. Thank you so much.
Watch COVID-19.